Hello everyone, I'm Chirag Bhandari, founder and CEO at Innoble Social Innovations and your host for this session. I would like to extend a very warm welcome to all of you for today's webinar. As many of you are already aware that we are doing a series of webinars on a very critical issue, which is COVID and its impact on rural schools, the learning loss, dropouts and child labor thereof, and why continued investment in education is a must. In this series, we have created a mini series where we are evaluating how connecting to students as regards to education, and especially in terms of language and science and maths needs to be looked at. And in this panel discussion, we are looking at language and CSR experts sharing their views on this idea. It looks like we already have about 100 odd participants, some participants waiting, and it's very exciting to see you all here. I would really like to acknowledge each one of you for being a part of this webinar. It's a Tuesday morning, 11 a.m., and we have so much to do, but still making time and being here really talks about your commitment to the rural education transformation in India. And this is something that is highly appreciable. Like I said, today's topic, it is about education and connecting students back to education in COVID times. As we know that schools have been shut over the past 1.5 years, and the abrupt closing of these schools has led almost about 6 million students, especially in the rural areas, to be completely or partially disconnected from education. This, like I said, is resulting in learning loss, students dropping out, child labor, and rampant child abuse, amongst some of the consequences. And broadly, if you were to look at these consequences, they are societal and economic. And in societal terms, we would probably have a lot of inequality, a rise in unskilled labor. But economic terms, if you were to understand probably this example of a World Bank report, which has just come out and which suggests that India would lose about $400 billion in its future earnings as a consequence of learning loss happening due to this pandemic. Now, this is a problem that does not have a simple solution. So you cannot have really funds coming in and probably, you know, some gadgets or et cetera being distributed to the students and be solving this issue. This is a very, very, very complex issue. And there are several crucial elements to it. One, of course, is lack of digital connectivity for many. And even where the connectivity is there, it is only for a few hours. The other challenge is, even when there is full digital connectivity, are we really wanting to have students being given the internet and devices so early? And many students, you know, they go to the schools for their midday meals. There's several unconfirmed reports that child marriages and child abuse rates have gone up. In terms of learning, there have been existing challenges wherein the learning rates of the schools have been low. Students do not find education engaging enough. And there have been several other challenges, like, you know, students or the way students acquire learning, that not being clearly understood by teachers, or you know, the way different subjects need to be approached differently, that not being appropriately trained well to the teachers. And it seems like the present pandemic will continue for a very long time, and at least for the next six months, 1 year, and maybe similar such situations might just occur in the future also. So we figured that since there are no easy answers to these challenges, our solution has to be comprehensive. It has to be contextual. It has to be robust. It has to be iterative, dynamic, and constantly evolving, so that these solutions, when they deliver, in the COVID times and beyond. And we need to really involve all the stakeholders in these discussions. As a consequence, we felt there's an imminent need to bring people who understand teaching learning processes around disciplines and those who are committed to investing in education on a common platform. to discuss the various possible solutions and then to test these solutions with the students in collaboration with parents and the community for its effectiveness. With this intent, we organized our first webinar, which was about a month ago on the 20th of May, wherein, you know, we had several participants and we all, I mean, and obviously a few distinguished panel members, and we discussed the possible solutions. And then we gained some very relevant ideas. This talk takes off from our last discussion. Here we intend to understand from various perspectives, from the education side and from the CSR side, as to how education is constructed and how it can be best acquired by students, and how or exactly what kind of learning needs to be prioritized in these challenging times. They're also looking at gaining a deeper understanding of what innovative ways are being looked at, can be looked at by the CSR fraternity. And finally, how the rest of us as a community can support overcome this challenge. This is our present understanding. We as an organization have constructed a plan to deal with the situation, to be able to reach out to the students and help them to continue education. However, since these are dynamic times where things can rapidly change, we are focused on constantly evolving and acquiring more ideas and experiences. And hence these discussions are very, very relevant. Whatever learning we gather out of these webinars would be tried and tested on the field, and so that our interventions can be made more sharper and we can look at some relevant solutions coming out for this challenge. To give you a brief introduction about Innovil, because the webinar series has been created and curated by Innovil. Innovil Social Innovations is a startup which is focused on developing sustainable and scalable solutions for school to create better learning ecosystems. Our flagship program, Yellow Green School, delivers on holistic transformation. It covers both the infrastructure, like the complete transformation of rural infrastructure, rural school infrastructure, and quality of education. Our infrastructure suggestions are in alignment with UNICEF and the government guidelines, and the quality education intervention obviously is in alignment with various government and state government policies. Founded in August 2018, Innovil has rapidly expanded across 58 plus districts across India, and we have done projects with several prestigious corporates like Mahindra Sustain, Godrej, NTPC, Suzlon, to name a few. We are incubated with AIC RMP and Atal Innovation Mission, and also incubated with IIM Bangalore, NSR CEL. We've won several awards, national and international, for our innovative products, namely Maharashtra State Innovation Award by Maharashtra Government, Simex Tech's Entrepreneurship Award in Mexico by Simex Tech, our own Innovation Award by Infosys Foundation, and a few more. Innovil also has an academic partnership with Vidya Bhavan Society, which was founded in 1931. And since then, we have been working, and they've been working very closely in quality education of children and youth and all sections of society. At present, Vidya Bhavan Society has grown to be a consortium of 13 institutions. So having set a background for this discussion and also explained about our work, I'd be very happy to introduce the panel that we have for today. And we have a very, very distinguished panel for today. I'm sure all of you will gain a lot of insights from this discussion, because this panel has really deep knowledge about their respective disciplines, and they come with a huge experience behind them. Please allow me to introduce our first speaker for today. Our first speaker is Mr. Gopalakrishnan Sridhar. Mr. Sridhar retired as an additional general manager, CSR at NTPC, and is BTech civil from IIT Madras. He has led the development of guidelines, processes, and procedures that are followed internally by NTPC CSR team. He's also represented NTPC point of view at various central and state government and PSU meetings. He has planned several managerial interventions for various prestigious institutes such as LEED, ISB, IIM, IRMA, etc. He has delivered keynote addresses on CSR across various PSU platforms and other CSR platforms. And most importantly, people aspect is so critical these days. And you know, when you speak to the team at CSR, the NTPC team at CSR, you get a sense that the team really respects him, and the kind of credit that is given to him to have the entire NTPC CSR strategy aligned, it's just incredible. Our second speaker for today is Dr. Ramakant Agnihotri. Dr. Ramakant Agnihotri is a doctor of philosophy, York University, UK, and is retired as head, Department of Linguistics, University of Delhi. He's currently Professor Emeritus, Vidya Bhavan Society, Udaipur. He has written extensively about applied linguistics, morphology, social linguistics, and research methods for several years. He has lectured in Germany, UK, USA, Canada, Yemen, and several countries across the globe. He has written over 15 books and published many articles on language. Many of his books are actually available on Amazon, and you can actually get a hold of them. He has also served as chairperson of the NCERT National Focus Group on the Teaching of Indian Languages. He has been an advisor to CBS, NCERT, SCERT, and DIET across the country, and also has helped several NGOs like Eklavya, Language Learning Foundation, and Dignar through his advice. And our third speaker for today is Dr. Avinash Kumar. Dr. Avnish Kumar, I'm really sorry for this. Dr. Avnish Kumar has more than 20 years of experience in the research and development sector, currently working as a director CSR with GMR Varalakshmi Foundation, where he is responsible for all the CSR activities at 20 plus locations across the country. Dr. Avnish holds a doctorate in environmental science and is certified in environmental education and sustainable development from Uppsala University, Sweden. He has published many research papers in international journals, co-authored several environmental educational books, and written articles in UN publications and newspapers. He has been selected as the top performing project leader for the Provention Consortium and has been invited to speak at the World Bank headquarters, Washington, and at the UN World Conference on Disaster Reduction at Kobe, Japan. He is a co-chair of the ASOCHAM National CSR Council and a member of CII and FICCI panels on education, skill development, and CSR. And lastly, I would like to introduce you to someone who is very special to our team at Noble because he also happens to be our mentor. He is Mr. Prasoon Kumar. He is an eminent education advisor working with Vidyavan Society, and has close to 23 years of experience in education. He is closely associated and has been closely associated with various state and national school education improvement programs, textbook writing, teacher training, and policy and curriculum development. Mr. Prasoon is the one who has actually conceptualized this idea of having various stakeholders from different spaces like education, CSR, coming together and discussing these ideas and trying to find a solution to this crisis. So we are extremely thankful for him to have this idea being suggested, and now it is coming to fruition. And finally, before we get started, I would like to share some base information. We would like to hear from you during the course of this webinar. In case you have any questions, any queries, please feel free to put them up in the chat, and our team will take hold of those questions, and they'll be put up in the question and answer round. I would also like you to be on mute for the entire session of this duration. Like you've been noticing, if there are some noises in the background, it really puts the speaker off. So kindly be on the mute. This discussion is also being streamed live on Facebook and YouTube. The link would be put up in the chat, so you can share this with your friends and family in case you feel they can benefit from this. A recorded version of this webinar will also be available on the YouTube, which can be used for later viewing. Our social media handles will be put up on the chat. So in case you like this conversation and you want to stay connected to this conversation, you can just like any of our handles, and then you'll be connected to these conversations. This session will last for about 100 minutes. We intend to finish this session by about 12:40 p.m. I would like to request you all to be present for this entire session. After my initial introduction, Prasoon sir would be setting the context of the discussion, and then post that we will have speakers expressing their views on various and sharing their experiences on this topic, and then we will be having a free flow of discussion and questions being invited from all of you. So without further ado, I would like to hand over the discussion to Mr. Prasoon Kumar. He's the one who will be kind of really setting the context for this discussion and taking this conversation forward.
Yeah. Good morning, Chirag, and everyone present for today's webinar. So I work as an educational advisor in Vidya Bhavan Society. Perhaps Vidya Bhavan Society is one of the oldest educational institutions in this part of Rajasthan. It is associated with many first education in the state and in the country, from nursery school to formalizing teacher education. The institution was, as Chirag rightly pointed out, the institution was founded in 1931. That's about me and the organization that is instrumental in many ways for today's webinar. Having said this, let me come directly to the point, so to save time for the very eminent panelists we have today to speak to us on the issues that Chirag has raised, and I'll also pinpoint those issues. So my note is basically summary of what happened in the last webinar and the discussion thereafter. You know, we all know children are missing school in a big way, and they are missing, it's a big learning omission for them. The act of going to school in itself is an act of learning, as it prepares children mentally to spend time to learn in a school within a structure. We need to examine that space and think out of box to replenish it as much as possible. I don't know how it will be possible, but since we have been thinking about it, some of it is possible. Another impact of closing down of school is basically the end of learning community around the child. Learning, you know, we all know learning happens everywhere in school, from playground to canteen to classroom. Learning community in a school is a set and a subset of children struggling to come to terms with the questions around a given piece of knowledge. When in a learning community, a child is free to ask fellow students, teachers, seniors to understand what they missed in the formal class. It is also given that learning is around the most obvious. Most of the learning is around obvious questions. But we don't ask those obvious questions because it makes us feel small. And that's the reason why you need to have a formal, informal committee around you to go and ask these small questions. But it remains the most important part of learning. So for example, go to a physicist. He'll tell you the structure of atom, but also that they don't know whether an atom is a wave or a particle. All this despite creating atom bombs that has potential to overkill us many times. Or go to a grammarian, you know, one Ramakanji is also here, and ask them about the use of a Hindi teacher, and ask them about the, tell the rule of how to use big E and small E in Hindi language. Beyond the point, they'll tell that, you know, you'll have to wait before we can tell you that, yeah, you are proved not to make mistake. So that's basically the point I'm trying to highlight is learning is based on obvious questions that children keep asking, and we keep discouraging them. And school and learning community is a place to explore those obvious. And we also know that most of the time, the complexity of these questions are learned outside the formal classroom. That's point number two. The third point, which is so much there in the air at this point of time, is about digital learning. If you go and talk to a teacher, since we have Vidya Bhavan as three schools, And we also work, our outreach program is around many more schools and many more children. Go and ask them in private, teacher, how digital learning is helping them. They'll tell you that, you know, if children had the ability to read and understand and make sense, their tasks of reaching to children with some kind of learning through digital mode would have been much, much, much more successful. And it's so obvious. You ask a grade, give a grade five child to read something from grade two or grade three, they'll not, most of the time they are not able to make sense. More difficult as one move from literature to grammar to math to the idea of science. So these are the three points which we have gathered from the last webinar and the discussion that we had after that. And it is also important to, before I end, I must point to the fact that we all need to raise question, raise disagreement, rather than agreeing to what the panelists say. That's how discussion and ideas grow. Imagine if somebody had not questioned Wright brothers' idea of flying aeroplane, we would not have today a jumbo jet, and we are still thinking how to further modify it. So please do ask question, please do show your disagreement, and please, even if you are not able to disagree at this point of time, go back and think about it and write back to us. And I hope the organizer will take care of your disagreement and get back to you. So let me finish here and hand over to Chirag so that we also get time to listen to the panelists that we have. Thank you, Chirag. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. And with this, I would like to invite our first panel member for today, Mr. Sridhar. I've already introduced him to you. Very excited to listen to you, Mr. Sridhar. Over to you.
Thank you, and good morning to everyone listening into this webinar. I'll be expressing my views through a small presentation, so let me share the presentation. Can you enable the sharing?
Sure.
Sir, it's enabled. You can present it.
No, it is showing host disabled participant screen sharing.
Sir, let me try. Sir, now?
Yeah. Yeah, it's there. Thank you once again, and welcome to this presentation. Management theory states that there are three steps in problem solving. The first step is that you have to recognize and accept the fact that there exists a problem. The second step is to understand the problem. It is said that understanding the problem is half the solution, actually the most important half. Albert Einstein had stated that given 1 hour to save the world, he would spend 55 minutes defining the problem and 5 minutes finding the solution. So important is this step. Step number three is to devise the solution to the problem. Let us now start recognizing the problem. This is the pre-pandemic normal classroom. The COVID-19 pandemic resulted in the imposition of lockdowns and near total closure of schools. This has caused the largest mass disruption of education in modern history. This has forced us to reimagine education so as to, number one, mitigate the impact of school closures, number two, address learning losses, and number three, adapt the education systems, particularly for the vulnerable and disadvantaged sections of the society. We may be able to devise solutions for the elite, but we are talking about vulnerable and disadvantaged sections of the society. In order to arrive at a solution that is both sustainable and scalable and financially viable, this is a very important concept that I'm introducing, we need to dive deep into and understand the problem in great detail. From online teaching and learning have been used by teachers and students in an unprecedented scale during this COVID pandemic. This has been touted as one of the most effective alternatives to classroom education. For a resource-constrained country like India, is this the most optimum solution? Will the solution address the needs of the vulnerable and disadvantaged sections of the society? Let us examine the problem in detail. The annual status of education report by the nonprofit Pratham reveals that smartphone ownership amongst children has increased from 37% in 2018 to 62% in 2020. However, the same report states that only 11% of the students are using online classes and 22% of the students are making use of recorded lessons. A staggering 67% students did not have access to any form of education. A UNICEF report titled COVID-19 and School Closures, 1 year of education disruption. We have talked about disruption in education. This report has been updated in March 2021, states that only 8.5% of school students in India have internet access. The digital divide is stark. Online education is still far from reality. Even among students who are able to access online classes, it has been found that 79% students are using smartphones and 21% students are either using laptops or tablets. A study has found that students find it much more difficult to learn while using smartphones compared to using laptops. So if we consider this student who is using a smartphone, she is definitely at a disadvantage compared to a student who is using a laptop. There is also the question of access to gadgets in families having more than one child. Do you think that this family can afford multiple gadgets? These questions have to be addressed while we define the solution. NTPC's power plants are located in mostly rural areas. My work in NTPC has given me the opportunity to have a first-hand knowledge of ground realities in remote rural areas. On the 17th of this month, there was a news item about a woman and her 5 children being hospitalized after battling hunger for 3 months. In the 2020 Global Hunger Index, India ranks 94th out of 107 countries. With a score of 27.2, India has a level of hunger that is considered serious. So many parents send their children to school just to ensure that their children have at least one proper meal a day. Even after 70 years of independence, schools do not have desks and benches and children sit on the floor. In NTPC, I remember that every year CSR budget allocation was made for Tatpatti. It's a jute mat on which children can sit. This is a close-up view of the school children sitting on Tatpatti. During my visit to stations, I would often face network connectivity issues outside of the plant premises whenever I visit the local villages around the power plant premises. Every solution also involves money. Let us take a close look at the money angle of the solution. If you look at the Union Budget of India for the current financial year, that is 2021-22, the total budget outlay was 34.8 trillion rupees. A trillion is 12 zeros. The total allocation for non-developmental expenditure, that is debt servicing, salaries and establishment of the government, defense and subsidies, amounts to 22.7 trillion rupees. Now, if we subtract this amount from the total budget outlay, we are left with 12.1 trillion rupees for development. The estimated CSR spend in 2019-20 was 18,000 crore rupees. This is put together of all the corporates in India. To put it in perspective, if we consider the 12 trillion from the government side for development as 12 rupees, CSR expenditure amounts to just 18 paise. So we have to come to the conclusion that CSR can never be the miracle cure for all the ills facing the country. creating a non-government parallel CSR solution for any problem is not only financially not viable, but also not a guarantee of success. What we need is appropriate, frugal innovation, ideas that leverage what we already have, rather than wishing for more or different things. Solutions to most of the critical problems that we are facing cannot be found in traditional models of CSR. Solutions can only be found if in shared responsibility, collective effort, and dispersed innovation. Taking a cue from the famous dialogue from the film Chak De India, I'm slightly modifying the actual dialogue. War karna hai to samne wale ke problem par nahi, samne wale ke dimag par karo, problem khud ba khud solve ho jayega. This is a very crucial insight from this dialogue from Chak De India. In order for any solution to be sustainable and scalable, CSR needs to empower people to take ownership of and solve their own problems. Let us look at some other factors which we need to consider for devising our solution. In the next 15 years, the world will change more than it has in the last 150 years. This is an important factor to be taken into consideration while devising our solution. If the solutions take a long time to implement, or they have, or in their impact, the world would have changed and moved on, and the solution would be rendered useless. Machines will do all repetitive tasks in the future. Today's children will most likely work in careers that we have not yet heard of. Humans will engage in careers that require emotional, social, and creative intelligence, where we have to focus our education on. So the solution that I am proposing and devising for you is a two-pronged approach that will tackle through activity-based teaching learning for lower classes. And the second is to focus on real world skills for students of higher classes, skills needed for success in the future. As discussed earlier, the solution will encourage local educated youth to take charge of their lives and develop and implement solutions for the local problems. The solution will adopt the model of train the trainer. Also known as cascade training, it is a cost-effective way for training many youth. An expert, typically an external consultant, trains a group of trainees and teaches them how best to train others in that subject. So for lower classes, trained local youth known as Shiksha Mitras will implement the improvement of learning levels through activity-based teaching learning using locally developed low-cost teaching learning materials. These are known as TLMs. For higher classes, we will focus on teaching the students real-world skills that are not taught in schools. Critical thinking, being part of the solution rather than being part of the problem, teamwork, time management, empathy, and social skills. Critical thinking involves questions of who, what, where, when, why, and how. Critical thinking can be encouraged by students taking part in debating. So you should encourage the formation of debating clubs in the local environment. If there has to be any solution that is sustainable and scalable, then people have to learn to become part of the solution and not be part of the problem. Quality circles, a concept from the manufacturing industry, is a tool which encourages people to become part of the solution. The predominant objective of quality circles is a change in attitude from I don't care to I do care. A small group of local youth come together to identify, analyze, and solve local problems. Quality circles encourage teamwork, helps in identifying hidden potential in team members, and quality circle members also learn to manage their time because they work in a project management mode. Daniel Goleman is one of the world's renowned psychologists. His article, What Makes a Leader, is one of 10 must-read articles as cited by Harvard Business Review, in which this article appeared. In this article, Daniel Goleman says that emotional intelligence is the sine qua non of leadership. When QC members, quality circle members, attempt to solve any problem, they move out of their comfort zones to to their stress zones. They encounter new environments and new challenges, which enhances their empathy and social skills, important components of emotional intelligence. Of course, all interventions will be undertaken using COVID-appropriate behavior. I will close the presentation with an aspiration of the famous leadership quote by Eleanor Roosevelt, who was the longest serving lady, first lady of the United States of America. A good CSR program is one which inspires people to have confidence in CSR. A great CSR program is one which inspires people to have confidence in themselves. This has been the guiding spirit of the solutions that I have proposed. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot, Sridhar sir. And you've shared some really invaluable ideas as to what are the base essential skills that need to be developed amongst students, which they can be empowered in their lives. Our next speaker for today is Dr. Ramakant Agnihotri. And as I've already explained, he is an expert in language, and he will be talking about ways in which we can create an engaged learner and how language can be used as a medium and how we can get students to acquire learning in these challenging times. Over to you, Ramakant sir.
Okay, can I start?
Sure.
Okay, first of all, I thank everyone who has come to attend the session. Thank Anubhav for having me here. And more than that, I thank Sridhar Saab for setting up the whole context so brilliantly. I think it saves everybody so much time because he has explained it in great detail what the COVID situation looks like. However, if you note one point that, you know, something that people like us keep talking about, that we do want, you know, leaders, we want great bureaucrats and doctors and engineers, and we want brilliant managers. But when it comes to education, we say that the budget is not there. We have to think of solutions which are minimal, minimally designed. So this is a thought for all of you to think about. I must turn to language, and I have a PowerPoint I can share, right? Share. And then I should be able to go somewhere too.
Yes, it's like.
Yeah, I wanted to make it full slide presentation. How do I do that? Because there is, I can't see it here. One sec. Remote control. Should be slide presentation somewhere. So only then you can see the whole thing.
On the bottom of the screen, next to the plus and minus, when it says 79%. Just to the left of it, the first button should be the
person. Oh, yeah. Is that okay?
No, you can press the first, right next to the minus sign. There's a...
Right to the language. Basically, the point I want to make with all of you is that if we want to connect with students and if we want to connect with teachers and the community, and with people who run the whole educational system, then we need to do, we can do it. I mean, we are bound. We are constrained by language. There is no other way in a digital world or in a non-digital world to connect with people without language. If that be the case, then it is important to understand the nature of language and the potential of the learner. So I'm going to spend the rest of the time on trying to share with you a very quick understanding of the nature of language and the potential of the learner. Trying to take you through two sets of data and try to show that if a four-year child can master that data, can abstract rules that govern language, then what should be the form of our education in pre-COVID, post-COVID, or in normal times? You see, we should all understand that even in normal times, our education is not anything to write home about. So I'm going to leave some of these things and go to the data. Okay, now the problem is, you see, I need to get this full screen. How do I get this full screen?
Sir, if you see on the top, there is a view option.
There is what?
View.
View, yes.
Yes, if you click there.
Yeah, and then zoom. Or fit to window. Fit to window.
Yeah, fit to window.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, you see these exam, anyway, never mind. Not working. So you see, look at this Hindi data. I want you to look at the first two examples. Mohan seb khata hai, Geeta seb khati hai. If you look at these two examples, then you see, you immediately figure out that first of all, a learner, a child has to internalize that there is an order to the words of subject, object, verb. So it's an SOV language, it's a verb final language. A child has to understand that. And then she has to figure out that the, and this is the general rule of Hindi, that the verb must agree with the subject, not just agree in one parameter, but in person, number, and gender. So if you see there are three persons, two numbers, and two genders, and therefore you have, if you have three tenses, there are at least 36 verbal forms. And sentences like one and two are sort of prototypes for millions of sentences which follow the same way in Hindi language. Now, when you go to number three, the child figures out, oh yeah, that of course is true. You know, if the number is, the subject is, plural, like ladke, the verb has to become khate hain. So khata changes to khate and hai changes to hain. So this highly abstract rule gets internalized. But by the time a child gets to four and five, you know, I mean, this is, as you can see, so complex. So it should be Mohan ne gajar khaya and Geeta ne gajar khai. But no, that's not how it is. You will get ungrammatical sentences. So a four-year child has to abstract the rule that if the subject is blocked, then the agreement is with the object. Once she comes to sentences like six and seven, which, you know, four-year children speak all the time, Geeta ne Mohan ko mara, Mohan ne mere bhai ne didi ko mara, didi ne bhai ko mara. So if there is something after the subject and also after the object, it is neutral. Okay, the verb has to be neutral. So this very complex abstract system of Hindi language is abstracted by a four-year-old child. It was abstracted by all of you also. All of you know the rules, but all of you don't know that you know the rules, which means you can't tell the rules, but they are at your subconscious knowledge. So this is the potential of the child that you have to keep in mind. Consider an example from English. Consider the sentences, the first sentences 1 to 5. So sentence like, I eat apples. So notice that the order here is subject, verb, object. This is a verb medial language. And Hindi was a verb final language. Now, millions of children across the world, certainly in India, Pakistan, and South Asia, Southeast Asia, learn English and Hindi together, for example. And they are not taken to hospital because they are learning SOV and SVO together. So from 1 to 5, I eat, you eat, we eat, you eat, they eat, you plural eat apples. You formulate a rule which says that use the first form of the verb in the present tense. It does not matter who the subject is. So there is an enormous structural pressure. Now, teachers don't understand this, that there is an enormous structural pressure on the child to make mistakes like, you know, she eat apples, okay? Or he eat apples, or he go to school. Because this is an error, you know, teachers keep correcting from class 3 to class 12. But it doesn't work because there is a structural pressure. What does this sir stand for? This is not S, huh? Please read it as sir. In sentences, this 1 and 2, he eats apples and she eats apples. Now imagine most people don't even understand what this sir stand for. I mean, this is so complex. I don't know how many people in the audience and how many people in the panel would be able to figure out what this stands for. At best, people say, oh, well, it is third person. It is not just third person. It is third person, present tense, singular. This sir is really atomic, sir. It has so much information, but a child internalizes that. So this is the potential of the child. I leave you with this problem that consider these three words. I hope you can see them. Sit, sits, and seats. There are 5 occurrences of the same sound, identical sound, phonologically, from the point of view of the study of language, there is no difference, but they are very different. How does a child figure this out? So think about it. This is a very complex issue. So if this is the potential of the child, and if this is the nature of language, what if this is the cognitive strength of the child with which she comes to school? We should understand one thing, that you cannot deliver education. You can only create spaces where learning becomes potentially feasible. There is no substitute for school, as Prasoon said, and as Sridhar Saab also said, because the kind of ecosystem that school provides is not possible. Irrespective of whether you go to digital learning or non-digital learning, what you need is rich, comprehensible, and challenging inputs, materials, activities, projects, and tasks. And because we want children to know their language, you see, the problem is we want children to know our languages, like Hindi and English. They are perfectly okay with Marwari and Mewari and Gujarati. No problem. Huh? Please understand this. So that is the issue. And that kind of acquisition can take place if there is an enormous amount of rich material around the child. Okay, only then it can take place. So languages cannot be learned through rote learning of grammar. Most grammar teaching is a waste. We teach grammar only because it gets you marks. Nobody can teach the kind of grammar I just showed you because nobody knows that grammar. Parents don't know that grammar, and teachers don't know. So it can't be taught. What can be done is to have texts, is to have rich texts in the form of picture stories, stories, poems, dialogues, you know, in whatever form, calendar forms, you know, there must be text which would make meaning, which would make sense. So meaning and making sense of the whole thing is far more important than it's very common. All of you must have seen that if you tell a story to a child in the night, she tells you the same story next morning in her own words. And we'll make some errors because errors are necessary stages in the process of learning. There is the question that we need to have highly trained and sensitive faculty. Having a B.Ed and M.Ed is not enough. It has to be an ongoing, lifelong process of a dialogic relationship between the universities and the people who sort of are constantly in the process of understanding and creating knowledge, and the teachers. Peer group work, there is no substitute. We need mobile libraries all the time, whether it is COVID or no COVID. And the digital material will have to be carefully planned. Even basic protocols, as you know, Shridhar, even basic protocols of mask, washing hands, and social distancing were not possible. Digital learning was a far cry. Over 70% students, as we saw just now, is out of the digital realm. But we should understand that technology is here to stay and multiply. Okay, but beware, no substitute for the learning spaces provided by the street, neighborhood, extended family, and school. I would like you to appreciate that the basic cognitive sort of skills outlined by Piaget are not acquired by a child before the age of 9 or 10, but languages. So language is special because children have innate language faculty, you know, specially genetically endowed with acquiring language. So let us make use of that in our educational processes. We therefore need to redesign the whole pedagogical process if we want to blend pedagogy, you know, in the digital and the non-digital fashion in the pandemic. For online work, we need to ensure electricity, connectivity, and dedicated devices and place to work. Worksheet booklets to be collected from school or dedicated center. We need to create WhatsApp groups. We need to create, you know, have sort of software systems which will create breakaway rooms, which are very useful so that peer group discussions and presentations are possible. Materials will have to be sensitive to gender, disability, cultural matrices, and the languages learner's role. What we have found that digital technology, if you have the devices, if you have all the facilities, it's very useful for capacity building of the faculty or of the field personnel. We can suggest that devices should be made available, you know, so the classes are held on Sundays and holidays. So devices are there at home and children can use it. We need to explore the use of platforms like Moodle, radio, and television. Explore it as much as possible. Schools may plan to have a, you know, device library, the data loaded things, and, you know, lend people devices and get them back. What we are looking for is blended transformative learning across the board, which means materials, teacher intervention, supplementary readings, assessment, all will have to be transformative. And we need to engage, as Shridhar Saab said, engage local educated youth in these new models. And we should understand the rights of digital learning and try to eliminate digital marginalization. Thank you very much. I think I was within time. I hope so. Thanks.
Thank you so much. Brilliant session and brilliant ideas shared by you. I'm sure everybody in the audience have really gained a lot of insight on the construction of language through your brilliant examples and obviously the ideas that you've suggested on what really needs to be done in these challenging times and beyond really give a lot of perspective on understanding of the problem and possibly devising some solutions to address this challenge. I would like to move on and invite our third speaker for the morning today. And he is Mr. Avnish Kumar. Like I said, he works with GMR and, you know, he'll be giving us a perspective or a CSR perspective to the situation. He has ground level experience and exposure on delivering education to rural India. So I would like to now welcome Mr. Avnish. Please take over.
Thank you, Chirag. And is the presentation visible?
Yes.
Okay. So I think with those introducing remarks by you and Prasoon sir, and later on these two presentations by Shridhar sir and Ramakant sir, I think most of the things that are needed and what is the current situation has very well been covered already, I think, very brilliantly by both the speakers and especially the language part now, which is very crucial in this pandemic era, because that's how the children start to learn and to communicate and all. And that being left out because of 1.5 years of and maybe, you know, continuing of this phase is really, really bad for the, you know, education scenario in the country. So as Chirag, you have told, I would probably give a more insight from, say, a practitioner point of view, or of what we have been trying to do for the last 1 year and what we are planning to do in the coming year, or what we have started. So that would be, you know, the part of my covering the whole scenario from our side. So just briefly, we'll start with the about GMR Vallashri Foundation, because many of the listeners might not be aware of what we are. So GMR Vallashri Foundation is basically the CSR arm of the GMR group of companies. GMR group, as you know, is a diversified infrastructure company having airports like Delhi and Hyderabad, several power plants and highways and all. So we are structured as a section 25, section 8 not-for-profit company. We have a separate board chaired by our chairman and several other eminent boards. And we have our own team. So we work directly with the communities. So while very many foundations work with a lot of NGOs and all at the ground with a very small team at the head office kind of thing, we have this philosophy that, or this strategy that we work directly at the community level. So we have 100 plus staff with us and a lot of other faculties and volunteers and all working at the field. We basically work with three thrust areas: education, health, and livelihoods. Education, health, hygiene, sanitation, and empowerment and livelihoods. Basically looking at, because these are the basic needs at the community level. So when you are a CSR, you have to look at what are the basic community needs and aim to, you know, somewhere fulfill them or supplement them from your side. So we are present in about 18 plus locations across the country. So basically looking at wherever the group has a business presence, we'll be working with the surrounding areas on these thrust areas. So it is mostly like, you know, a lot of places in north and south and all, but a little less in, you can say, west and eastern part of India. Because we'll be talking of the education part and how do we reach to the rural schools in this pandemic era and all. So just briefly on how we have been doing education, helping in, you know, reaching out to the schools and all in rural and remote areas. So we work with about 200 government schools. So our philosophy is that whichever are the government schools neighboring our business area, we'll be working with them on improving the quality of education. So in improving the quality of education, as been told earlier, infrastructure is one part of it. So many government schools might not have enough classrooms or maybe toilets or such infrastructure. We'll of course supplement them, but we also look at how do we actually increase the learning levels, how do we increase the performance of the children and such things. So for that, various kinds of activities happens. And this special point we mentioned for this session also, that we have embarked upon, you know, introducing e-education or help, getting help of the technology in teaching part by having these e-classrooms in the schools, in the government schools. So we have these projectors and computers and the e-content bought in by some partner. So which is, you know, then helps the teacher to actually make the children learn better, faster, and make their understanding better. So we had already started this, and in many of our schools, these e-learning centers are already present, and there's a special teacher who takes up these classes, and the subject teachers comes in who, you know, gets this supplementary facility in the school. Besides that, we also work at the pre-primary level, at the Anganwadi and Balwadi's level also, again, looking at how do we prepare the children to inter schools. So that is our thrust there. We also help children prepare for the Navodaya and NMMS scholarship exams, where the, you know, children's future is quite well decided if he clears these kind of tests and gets into a nice Navodaya school from the government side. We also have a very special scheme called the Gifted Children Scheme. This is a very targeted children scheme where we select children based on both economic and you know, merit grounds and support their education from first standard up to their first job. So it's a very long commitment, and we started this about 15 years back. And the first you know, batches who were supported from first standard, they have actually passed out and are last year onwards, and they are now into, some are engineers, some are preparing for CA, some are, you know, into other professions. So it is a very targeted scheme for our you know, surrounding areas, but and they get admitted to the schools which are run by our GMR with a partner there. So this is briefly about what we do. So coming on to what we have been doing on the ground, I mean, no one was prepared for this kind of thing to happen in any area. And so so far for even education area, how do we reach out? Where our whole intervention was at the school level. So what do we do when the schools get closed and there are so many restrictions on movement, on gathering, on all kinds of things and all social distancing, everything has to be followed. So of course, we also looked at technology interventions and all that, but we soon discovered, as already been said by every speaker, that there is a great digital divide, and there is also a great digital difference among even the people who are having those kind of digital devices and all. And if you are working with government schools, especially in the rural areas, in the remote areas and all, considering interventions which are largely dependent on technology and those kind of things, smartphones and those, was not a very feasible solution, or was not a solution which could actually reach out and benefit the students that we are catering to. So what we thought is, we already had a lot of Vidya volunteers with us, because they were working as you can say additional teachers at the school level, because most of the government schools, one of the problem is that there are less number of teachers. That is a recurring problem and everywhere around the country. So we had these Vidya volunteers from our side. We had these computer center volunteers from our side, and other volunteers also. So we engaged them to make small study circle kind of thing, where the small groups of children, only 4 or 5 children or maximum 7 or 8 children, were used to gather in the school premises or in any community area and all. And the Vidya volunteer or some senior student from the school also. So that was also one thing that we did, that we identified good senior student from that village only. And these children and these volunteers, they assembled the children within the village in a very safe environment and keeping social distancing and all. And then they practiced there in the guidance of these senior children or the Vidya volunteers. So this worked well. This was hardly for about 2 hours in a day. And we had some specialized worksheets from our side, workbooks from our side, which we have given, and the children used to work on that. Apart from this, we also made WhatsApp groups. So that was also used for even smaller children also to send some kind of videos or some assignments. But I would not say that it was the principal means of intervention, or that was the main means of intervention. And we expected that every child should be able to, read it and respond to it and all. So that was not there. But even if a child can get access, so that kind of thing was also provided. So as I said, that we have made these workbooks, you can see in the first photo. So we had made these, and thousands of these were distributed to children at the primary level. This was for up to 1st to 5th. So we just included in a very, activity-based kind of thing. So it was not a very formal kind of, question, answer or content that was there. So very pictorial kind of workbooks that we had designed on each concept, on major subjects or topics that the children cover in their standard. And these were distributed physically. And then again, it was a kind of Vidya volunteer or the senior child visiting the house and then looking at what the child has done and how he has performed or what he is not able to understand, how we can better it and how we can guide the child. So this was very, very useful, and almost all children were able to fill the whole workbook through the year. And this is something that we again plan to use it in this year also. For higher standard children, 9th and 10th class children, we were cognizant that they might have better access to technology and they might be able to understand it better also through a phone or something like that. And so we tied up with some other partners who provided some apps and other technologies free of cost. And this was given to these higher students children, and they used it also very effectively. So we have used this Convey Genius app last year, and now this year we are using another app called Teachment. So these are very convenient and very interactive kind of thing also can happen with the students, that those are having access to these devices. We have also tied up with another agency which has a very Google Map kind of thing, where we can see the level of the student, where he or she is at present, and where she or has to reach, over the academic year. So it's a micro competency kind of based framework, where we map the competencies for each subject and each topic. And based on the teaching which is happening, based on the assessment which is happening, the learner progresses slowly. And this learning is monitored on this app very effectively for each child. So it's a very individual centered kind of thing. So we piloted it last year, because anyway, we are trying to make use of technology and make our Vidya volunteers, our teachers and our learners also familiar with that. So it was piloted with that, and it had very good results. Though of course technology is at the backbone of this, but what could be the better time to try it, because everyone is trying to make use of technology to use it. So it has reached very well. For math subject, we have tried it, and it has worked out well for the volunteer to see the competency levels progress. So in the second wave, I mean, based on this experience that we have from the last year and what are the different, so everything last year was our kind of experiment and trying and, you know, different kinds of things. Let's do this. Let's innovate with this. Let's partner with them. Let's try to reach out like this. So whatever we had tried this time, we thought that we have to be more structured in our, you know, approach, in our strategy, because we have the experience of last time. And as, you know, Chirag has also told, while schools may start opening in a phased manner and all, but maybe next 3 to 6 months, still a lot of it will happen in a non-physical mode or in a very restricted physical mode and all. So we should be prepared in a good strategy how to reach out. So this time we are, very strategically dividing the whole thing, the whole approach into 3 levels, the primary level, middle level, and the high school level. Again, going on by what experience we had. So the primary level children, they don't have access, or even if they do have access, they don't have such familiarity for the online mediums and all. So we will continue with them with mostly offline methods. So study circles, learning circles, and using the workbooks and all will be our, you can say, principal means of reaching out. And we have already started that. More printing of workbooks and worksheets have started. And plus what we are also doing this year is that we are doing 2 things. We are mapping their learning levels, the minimum learning levels, the MLL approach, and seeing what, you know, have they actually lost from the last year. So all the concepts which they should have learned in first standard or second standard or third standard, do they still retain it, or have they completely lost it, or what level they are? Then accordingly, the approach could be with those children depending to on their current level and reaching to the MLL for that standard. And also this time, very structurally, we are trying to map the digital access. So child-wise kind of thing. So last year was at all, okay, we will do this kind of intervention with up to this level and, above that, we'll have more online content and all that. But this time, we are trying to map the digital access. How many children, when do they have? Like Ramakant sir also said, maybe we can use Sundays where people have, actually children can have access to the smartphone, even if they have only one smartphone with the father. So like that kind of thing, or whether we do it in evening time. WhatsApp has, I think one of the means that has worked well, especially for the assignments and assessments that we have passed down. So that will continue to be used. And for the high school students, there would be more stress on preparing for board exams, whether they, hopefully they should happen next year. I mean, we should not say that they should not. Physical board exams should happen. So we will focus on how to prepare them, not only by the regular teaching, but by bringing in some subject experts, mock tests and all that. And overall, last year, a lot of it has happened. But this year also, we will try to, have more capacity building of our teachers, which all the previous speakers have also emphasized. That's while we are trying to switch or by trying to use both the mediums, that capacity building of the main proponent, that is the teacher or the Vidya volunteer and all, has to happen to handle this kind of blended learning modules. So that will also be one of our stress in this coming month. So this is how we are planning that for the primary school, we will continue to use our workbooks, maybe in very large number. So there have been a lot of other government programs which will dovetail, and we'll try to work with those government programs and do this. Study circles with each mentor working with about 4 or 5 children. And for smaller children as well as up to middle level classes and all, we also used a lot of art and craft kind of thing last year. So that also very, structurally this time, that every week there should be at least 2 classes where we promote art, we promote creativity, and those kind of things will also happen. And using the other apps or other YouTube and other medium to pass on the worksheets, assignments, and videos will for this level of school children. Similarly, for the middle school, for 6 to 8, we will map, and if the children have access to digital devices, more content can be passed on to those children. But a very structural mapping of the MLLs, so that at this phase, they should be at least very much prepared and learnt about the concept at the middle school, so that when they are coming on to the high school level 9th and 10th, they are fully familiar with that. Again, approach of study circles and extracurricular will go on, and low tech based teaching will happen at this level, which might not be so much at the primary level. At the high school level, we will group for both online and offline sessions. So like, making a very structured kind of timetable for people having online access. And we hope that the number or percentage will be higher at this level. and also looking at the convenient time. So it can be the evening, or it can be Sundays, or it can be some other holidays and all that we can do that. And also offline kind of thing. If the COVID goes down and some assembly of children is allowed, then we can do a lot of things offline also, involving expert teachers for each language, subjects and other things. A lot of study material and digital content can be passed on at this level, which they can see or go through it at their convenient time. Revision, when we were working physically also for the high school level, one of the main things that we kept on doing was revision for the last 4 or 5 months. So that will again continue like before in whatever medium we do. And some project works and assignments will also be assigned, as Sridhar sir has said, that real time, real life working kind of thing. How do you actually see the concept in real life? How do you use it in real life? Those kind of project works also we will encourage, which the child can do individually or as a group. So that kind of approach will also be adopted for the high school children. So if you want to actually scale up, and how do we do this? Because as GMRVF also, we are reaching out to about 200 government schools, which is minuscule if you look at the national figures. And within this 200, if you look at each location, we might be working with, say, 5 schools, 10 schools or 15 schools like that. But we have to reach out to all the children. We have to reach out to a large percentage of children. So the best way of doing that is, we found, is to work with the government, because government itself, their education departments and all, Sarv Shiksha Abhiyan, they are trying a lot of different methods. So like Himachal, we have that concept from Himachal government, state government, Har Ghar Pathshala. So in this, what they used to do is, from government side, they used to send a small WhatsApp kind of things to the parents' numbers. And then our Vidya volunteers actually helped them to complete these assignments. So which was because the teacher was not available, parent is not having that knowledge and all that. So it is like, fulfilling the government initiative in that sense. Similarly, in AP, we had a program where assignments were given from the government side. So our volunteers used to help the children to complete those assignments. Then, very good programs which have been telecasted at both Telangana and Andhra Pradesh by the Doordarshan channel. So Doordarshan, a TV everyone is having these days, and Doordarshan channels are free. So we saw the timetable which was published by the government, that at what standard, what topic will be covered in each day. So this, our role was just to publicize it and just to make sure that those children in the villages are actually attending, those classes at that time from the Doordarshan, which is universally available. So in this way, we looked at some models which can help us even in a small scale. And if you want to scale up, how do we just dovetail to the government efforts and all. So as most speakers have also said, that online education suddenly became like, everyone can do that, but we know that it is not a suitable alternative at all. It is not a long-term solution at all. That school environment, the teacher, everything has to be factored. Even if we overcome the digital divide, which is a reality now, and we can't shy away from that. So there is no question that we can do everything online. But even if we overcome that, it is not any alternative for the physical space that a school brings. Innovative blended ways are needed. Everyone has talked about radio, television and all that. And offline classes, I would say, even in this pandemic time, as and when there is relaxation, and now it is hopefully happening more, we should try to do more with all safety and precautions that had to be taken. Other suggestions, other things that we know is that online education, mostly the content is available in English. So efforts of most of the NGOs, the foundations and everyone working in this space is towards how do we make it happen more in vernacular languages, because that's what a rural school or a rural child is more familiar with. So English is not the preferred medium, though, a lot of even state governments are now having English medium schools or English, overall English medium also. So, but we have to see that, the child understanding is more in the vernacular language. And if we can provide the education content in vernacular, it's very good. Capacity building of the teacher, of every stakeholder who is involved in this kind of blended learning, has to be more. It has just been introduced last year. People are not so familiar. Even we are not familiar, when these meetings, if instead of Zoom, there was another platform, maybe a Google Meet, I'll also be struggling to how to project and how to do this. So, there is a lot of challenges which this whole technology poses. So it's not a very easy medium. So that kind of thing also has to happen for everyone. And more open source educational resources, if they are used, and there are a lot of resources by the, Ministry of HRD and other, which is there. So popularize them and let teachers, let children use them. That would be, I think, most beneficial. So that is what from our side, from what we have been doing and what we are planning to do, and some other suggestions. I hope we will be able to make some difference with all of us getting together. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Avneesh, for that loaded session wherein you had so much data and so much information and so much details of the various experiments that you have done and the solutions that you feel and your team feels are really working on ground. I'm sure everybody has really benefited from these ideas quite a lot. And with your session coming to conclusion, I would quickly like to invite questions from the audience in case they have any questions, in case, for any of the specific speakers.
Chirag, could I take minutes if you want? You see, I think I rushed through a lot and I now realize took about 13 minutes. So could I get back to my first slide and take 2-3 minutes to make some points? Is that okay?
Sure, sir.
Is that all right with you?
Yes, absolutely.
So I think just to tie things up together.
Yes.
So if you allow me just 1 second, because this thing doesn't seem to work.
One second.
Can you see the slide now?
Yes.
Okay. So I just want to take 2-3 minutes more. You see, the first point I want to make was that the issues that I was trying to raise. Oh, I can't be seen. The issues I was trying to raise were about language and education. They're not just about language, okay? Because can you see the screen?
Sure, we can.
Okay. So, you see, as I have been saying, we never ask. Everybody asks us how. How should we teach language? How should we teach mathematics? How should we teach science? We rarely ask what is language, what is maths, what is science. Unless we ask the what of it, we will not be able to understand the how of it. Okay, this is what I have been trying to say. And I would like the audience present to appreciate that what I was trying to show through my examples was the what of it. What is the nature of language? And we need to understand that all knowledge transmission and construction takes through language. So, whether you talk of middle school or high school or, university, we are created through our language. Language is constitutive of our being. We call something a tree because our language tells us to tell it's a tree. If it tells us to say ped, we will say ped. If it tells us to say gach, we'll say gach. So what I'm saying is our conceptual machinery is created through language. That is why it is so important to understand this. So this is what I've said. Irrespective of what is your discipline, it is coded and decoded in language. And this is what I try to show, that language is a highly abstract system which is rule governed at the level of sounds, words, and sentences and discourse level, and also very flexible. To accommodate all kinds of situations. And this kind of system cannot be acquired through a PP model, through imitation and practice, because you speak infinite number of new sentences every day. This cannot be acquired through, what is called the pattern practice model and the imitation model. That is definitely mistaken. So I think I'll stop there. I thought that's all I wanted to say to add to what I had said. I hope that's fine. And I can say stop sharing.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for actually covering something that you think would add value to our audience understanding. I'm sure this has actually helped them understand the overall aspects of language in education that you were trying to explain. I have one question for you, sir. There are several questions that are coming to me. So I will start with a question to you. What is the role that you feel parents should be playing in these times, and how important it is to really empower them so that the education of students can continue?
You see, depends, Chirag, what kind of social level we are talking about. Okay, if you are talking about the lower middle class, and the upper class, they are already doing it. If we are talking of the 70% underprivileged, you know, and the marginalized, I think that's what this webinar is about. So the first thing we need to understand is that these people are, first of all, trying to make two ends meet. And particularly in COVID times, so many people have lost jobs. Okay. So I don't think, what you can do is, take a lot of materials to them and, you know, keep the materials at home so that parents get involved in them. The other thing we can do is the other side of the story, you know, a dialogic relationship. Let us not assume that we have to tell something to the parents. Parents have an enormous amount of knowledge, and the people who work in the field, we should have the systems to imbibe that knowledge, you know, whether that is about crops or agriculture or about carpentry or whatever, you know, we need to bring that into the educational system. Okay, so this is not a one-way dialogue. So we can do things, but we should be open. Thirdly, we must understand that the parents have the linguistic capacities, that we are not able to explain mathematics to them or English to them or Hindi to them or physics to them is our problem, not their problem. Let us not assume that social sciences or physics or chemistry cannot be done in Gujarati or Marathi or Mewadi or Marwadi. It can be. The highest kind of mathematics can be done. So, you know, this is the level of understanding we need to have.
Got it, sir.
I think for the parents, if I may just, you know, add one point, which, you know, we are now we have already started, is apart from, you know, involving them how to, you know, for the education part and all, I think one thing we have to do a lot is to have the parents vaccinated. You know, that is very, very important. In rural India, it is, the pandemic has also reached rural India, and there is not so much awareness and all. So one of our effort is to how to get the parents vaccinated, because that is very, very important for the family overall. I mean, education is only a part of it. And we have seen that, you know, there are children who have been orphaned completely with both father and mother, or the male earning member, is coming to COVID. So we have taken it as a kind of mission mode that we have to get the parents vaccinated. And I mean, whether true or not, whether the children will be affected more or not, there are some media reports is that, though there is no much concrete evidence, but even if that happens, the child will not be living alone or will not be left alone, you know, in like a COVID ward or something. The parents are needed. So it's very, very important that apart from everything else that we are doing for education or whatever, we have to make sure that the parents get vaccinated. We are facilitating that. We are taking them to the COVID center. We are booking the COVID slots and all that. So I think every organization, NGO, foundation, whether we are working on education or health or whatever, I think this is the time in the next 2-3 months, we make all efforts to get the parents vaccinated.
I agree with you, Avinash, completely, but only with one rider, that we will succeed in this effort, in this enterprise, only if we are able to talk in their language.
Yeah.
If we keep talking in our language, it will be, might be a disaster.
Of course.
I have a question for Sridhar, sir, wherein, and I would request all the panelists to be on the video, please. So that would help them to be on the spotlight. So, just trying to make sense of this question. Okay. So how can the government and educationalist and CSR come together? And that is our attempt here also. And you suggested this idea of delving into the problem deeper. So besides this platform, what are the other ways in which all of them can come together and delve deeper into the problem and probably really understand it to the very core and come up with solutions?
One of the key ways, like Avnish was telling from GMR perspective, some of the solutions that you can implement and show the way for the government to scale it up. You start small, you show that this can be implemented, and then the government takes it up and carries it out further. This is one of the ways where the corporates and governments can come together. This is one way. Number two, the role of parents was coming up. Parents also in rural areas, I am very specific that, again, they have to own the problem. For owning the problem, they have to come forward and ensure that proper education is happening in the village schools, for which they have to come together. And what I have told, in a non-confrontational way, they have to take it up with the local administration and the schools to ensure that teachers are present, they are not absent. The required infrastructure is there. Or they may also come together and pool some resources and develop whatever resources are missing in a small way. Not go full ahead with it, but you can take it up with the governments in certain ways. So these are the ways that people, corporates, and the government can come together.
All right. Prasun sir, I have one question for you. The question is coming from Mega. So what struggles of quality learning are amplified due to COVID?
Yeah, so like I said, you know, we need to create, there is a shift from a learning formal structure in the school to a learning structure which is there in your at home and you are around that. So within that, you have to explore what is possible. So how do you use your parents, their understanding, their idea, how do you interact with the nearby neighboring peer group. All these, so for example, simple things like you can ask students to come up with a story, and children who can write story, they should write story. They can develop story talking to their parents. Similarly, you can have n number of mathematical exercise which will give children opportunity to work with their parents and still be learning basic concepts of mathematics like counting, addition, subtraction. Even, you know, for example, you can play Ludo and you can find out, you can give one task how many times six gets repeated and make a list of that, and on the basis of probability theory, you can predict that. So there are n number of and also science, where you can develop ability to think rationally. So what I would like to say that one thing that we pick from school, which Ramakanthji has also pointed, is inquiry. So you need to create, and that's how knowledge is created. So if you repeat what you have been doing in your school digital medium, it will not be that effective, because it's also not effective when it comes to be an independent reader and understanding a text. So that's also not very, it's not a happy situation even in school. So you have to dig from the context where children are placed, rather than Avinash has said that I think it's a long time. It will take another 6 to 8 months before primary school children, they are in the school. And for a primary school children to move from class one to, or class two to class four without going to school, conceptually, it's a big, big jump. They'll never be able to make up if we are not, we don't get worried about it right now at this point of time. Yeah.
Yeah, so we are actually pressed for time and we have a last few minutes left. Can I request all of you to probably to share your parting notes on this discussion? You've heard all the speakers and you know you've kind of gathered some ideas. So if you could just summarize your views on this in a minute, you know, the message that you would want the audience to kind of take from here. And I would again begin with Sridhar sir.
I have been repeatedly saying that no solution will be there if the beneficiaries are not going to play a major role in the implementation of the solution. They have to come together, we have to empower them, and then create the solution. This is the only way that CSR can really benefit the society at large. Otherwise, the funds are so limited. So you have to develop solutions that can scale and that can be replicated, and the government then takes it over. That is the amount of money that the government is spending in the development of the country. I told the 12 rupees against 18 paise from the CSR point of view. That is the huge gap between the funding that is available to government and to the CSR. So we have to be very sure that we should develop solutions which can be replicated at scale and then pass it on to the government to take it over and put it into action.
Thank you, sir. Ramakant, sir?
Yeah. First of all, I think as most of us have indicated, there are no shortcuts. So this needs to be internalized. Secondly, I think all of us also said that these are conceptually and pedagogically and implementation-wise constantly evolving kind of proposals and solutions. Thirdly, I think in spite of the trillions Sridhar Saab talked about, you see, since 1964, Kothari Commission suggested 6% budget on the education. The government budget on education has never exceeded 4%. And same thing with CSR. What I'm saying is, I'm not saying, see, for example, on defense, maybe we can't reduce the budget with China and Pakistan or whatever. But if you want that other things are central, like health, for example, or like technology is central to you, and you want the best of people, you better invest more in education. Okay, I mean, the minimum amount is, even in the case of CSR, you're saying we have to do with the minimum. Why with the minimum? The greater part of the CSR chunk should come to education. And then health will automatically improve. This is my argument. And finally, as I said, that the bottom line for all this negotiation and for all knowledge acquisition and construction is language. And in the case of language, I would say the languages of the learners must be privileged. You know, we keep neglecting them. I am saying that the languages of the learners in the classroom must be privileged. And there are ways in a multilingual paradigm to privilege their languages and to enhance their cognitive abilities. I mean, that's a long session, but it is possible.
Got it, sir. Thank you so much. Avnish.
Yeah, no, one or two things. See, one thing that, you know, we can do from the government side, it should come actually, which was also discussed and done a little bit last year, is to look at the curriculum part. I mean, if the whole academic year is getting shortened and there are, you know, whether it's online or offline, if we get offline, it will be maybe a couple of months or 4 months, 5 months. Even online, you can't have 6 hour, 8 hour teaching kind of thing. So how do the state board, the central board and all reduce the curriculum? Because this is not practical to teach the same thing which you are doing in pre-pandemic times. So that is something that government and education department should come forward. What is the most essential? The basic learning levels that the, you know, that standard prescribes and that the, you know, student should acquire. So that kind of exercise should be done at the both state and the central level. And that should become a norm for this year, for this and maybe the coming year also, that this has to happen at each level. And it is not the same curriculum which has to be followed. Then all from the, you know, the part of the school level, I think though a lot of stress has been only on the education part. But as Ramakant sir has also said, it is, you know, school was basically a space where every, you know, child gathered and they had peer-to-peer learning or interactions and all that. So how do we promote that kind of things also? Because if we use only this as one medium of getting more lessons, assignments, projects, all that, the student is already very alone and struggling through it. So how do we create such spaces where it is just Sunday a WhatsApp group video call among the children? Those kind of things, they just find out what they have been doing or what has happened in their village or something like that. So that kind of interaction, some art, some this, then all, that should also happen. The social part of it also should happen in some way or the other. So where CSRs can also play a good role, the government can also play a good role. And CSR also has to play a good role, I think, in the reopening of schools. Because again, while there would be some budget and all that, whether the school would be fully sanitized, whether, those kind of sanitizers, hand sanitizers, mask, everything will be available or not, the social distancing kind of norm and all, there CSRs can play a role in making those kind of arrangements, which we are also started.
Excellent. Finally, Prasoon sir, any concluding notes?
Yeah, so two points I'd like to make. One is that you can't understand the present without understanding your what you have been doing in the past. So it can't be disconnected. So to understand the present, you also have to look back what you have been doing over these years. And we also have to understand it's also connected. We also have to understand that despite government investing so much, government is at the mammoth present everywhere. In every aspect of learning, and also with the CSR program since last 20 years or at least 15 odd years, still we have 30% children reaching class 10. And when you talk about learning, so there are lots of reports, the PISA report, the ASR report, which says that children are not learning. The way we understand learning, the way Rama Gandhi was talking about learning. So we have to look back, sit back and look back what wrong we have been doing, and we need to disconnect that or add value to it so that more children they can learn. So that's what I think is important to answer.
All right. So I think a brilliant session overall, and we are just coming towards the closure of it. And very quickly, I think we've had ideas coming in from Sridhar sir, wherein he's really emphasized to get the community in and to have them participate. And then his point that, overall funds are limited and we need to have frugal ideas and frugal ideas being promoted and scaled across. And then Agnihotri sir arguing that funds are important towards education and then government should spend and probably more budget should be provided. And also his ideation on how, or his explanation on how language is constructed and how we can help create, or we should provide students with rich text so that they can acquire learning rich text and conducive learning environments. And I think very appropriately Avnish contributing that base learning levels need to be defined, and we need to have state and government levels really getting to work on having students acquire these base learning levels, and obviously also suggesting that creating conducive learning. And finally, Prasoon sir suggesting that there has been a lot of wrong, which is not really, a lot of things which have not really gone well in terms of education over past, and we need to really evaluate what all is not really working. And then those things need to be worked at while these new solutions are being implemented. And that is how we will, or we would probably together look at some credible solutions. So I think a brilliant and a sensational discussion here. I'm sure everybody who's attended this has benefited greatly from all these ideas and views shared. I am very, very thankful to all the three panelists and Prasoon sir, who's always been supportive of this program and helped us really get this program to this level. Finally, as a parting note, for all the participating members, this was a grave issue. Education is a grave issue and would continue to be a grave issue over the next couple of months and years. We all need to come together and sincerely discuss and debate these ideas. There are no clear-cut solutions that are emerging right now, but if we all come together as a community and contribute ideas, we can possibly look at overcoming these challenges. India is one of the most youngest nations across the globe. And if we are able to really empower our population with the right education, we can truly become a global superpower. We will be getting back to you with a document on all the learnings that have been acquired in this session. So please go through that document and stay tuned for our next webinar, which is tentatively planned on the 1st of July, wherein we'll be discussing the CSR impact and how they can contribute, and also understanding how specific language